Once they settled in America, both mafia factions maintained the vendetta in this country as they had back in the old country. As the years passed, Magaddino got word from his allies back in Sicily that one of his brother's suspected killers, Camillo Caiozza, had sailed to New York City. In time, he was able to track Caiozza down and arrange the deed. While Camillo was in New York visiting his family, Cieravo knew of the gang and understood that Fontana had no reasonable option other than to murder his friend. The innkeeper offered Fontana the use of a shotgun and recommended that the deed be done in the woods away from the inn. Caiozzo returned to Neptune City on Sunday, and he and Fontana went duck hunting the following day. The two men ventured toward an overgrown and marshy area along the Shark River. Fontana, holding Cherevo's shotgun, lagged just a step behind Caiozzo as they hiked. When the men were out of sight of the inn, Fontana put the muzzle of the shotgun against his old friend's back and jerked the trigger. The weapon seems to have been loaded for more than birds. Lead slugs ripped a large hole through Caiozzo's back and side. Panicked and stricken with guilt, Fontana rushed back to the inn, leaving Caiozzo where he had fallen. Cieravo wanted to know where the killing had taken place, Fontana pointing to a spot not far off. Cieravo was angered. "I told you to go far away, to spoil my house!" Leaving murder victims lying around the property wasn't good for business. Cieravo grabbed a shovel and had Fontana lead him to Caiozzo's body. When they reached the site, Cieravo tried to have Fontana bury his friend. Fontana refused. Disgusted, Cieravo dragged the body a dozen or so paces away and hid it in some brush. The two men then walked towards Cieravo's home on Embury Avenue, stopping along the way for Cieravo to have a brief discussion with his friend Giuseppe Lombardi, a member of the Good Killers gang. Lombardi immediately departed for New York before dawn the next morning. Lombardi returned to Neptune City accompanied by Francesco Puma. With help from Fontana and Cieravo, they located Caiozzo's remains, tied stones to the body, and sank it in the water of Shark River. The men then adjourned to a 4 a.m. breakfast at Newton's Luncheon near the local train station and returned via train to New York. As he reached the city, Fontana became concerned for his future. Lombardi and Puma reportedly urged him to visit Brooklyn with them. Fontana imagined himself thrown alive into a Bonventre bakery oven and understandably declined the invitation. The small, skinny 28-year-old Bartolo Fontana was a barber and he was being guarded by a Brooklynite named Fischetti, who was a detective police sergeant in the New York Department Italian Squad, and he had major shoes to fill as the previous detective in his role before him was a legend as he was martyred in 1909 on an official trip to Palermo, Sicily. Fischetti was a street-smart and husky cigar-chewing investigator, resting in his Broadway Central Hotel bed with the revolver under his pillow. Awakened by the pacing of Fontana, he remained still, feigning sleep and listening until Fontana popped up at his windowsill, shouting in the late summer dawn, yelling in his Sicilian dialect,
"My God, he was my friend, my brother, and I killed him. But you know, my good God, I didn't want to do it. I had to do it. They made me kill him."
Fischetti switched on the light and asked why Fontana was up so early. The two had a conversation in Italian as the mumbling, clammy Fontana admitted to killing Camillo Caiozzo and throwing his body into the river. But the detective already knew, as he was supplied with the information by a Brooklyn girl named Carmela Pino, in love with Fontana but rejected by him. Fischetti was holding on to the specifics while escorting Fontana to a Broadway show, taking him to dinner, staying with him at the hotel that night. Then Fischetti played his ace. "I don't want to see you go to the chair when you're not to blame. I want to get them. I want to get them for making you kill your friend." Fontana said that the good killers were responsible for at least 16 other murders. Some of these victims he named were connected to the rival Buccellato family in Castellammare del Golfo. These included three Buccellato brothers living in Detroit. Salvatore, Felice, and Joseph killed in 1917 through 19, and their cousin Pietro Buccellato killed in 1917. Fontana also indicated that good killers were responsible for the Ginola brothers, Joseph Ponzo and Francesco Fanazzo in Brooklyn, Luca Sarcona and Andrea Licato, father and son Pietro and Joseph Bosco, and others. He could not provide dates and locations for those murders. He mentioned Antonio Tony Ginola was shot down as he stepped from his automobile at Rivard Street on January 4, 1919. He's said to be on his way to pay respects to the family of Pietro Bosco, recently killed in Bosco's garage at Trumbull Avenue and Ash Street. The two men who served as Ginola's driver and bodyguard that day vanished after Antonio was killed. They were suspected of performing or cooperating in the assassination. Joseph Bosco soon followed his father. Salvatore Sam Ginola was eliminated following an October 3, 1919 bank visit. The gunman did a thorough job. He reportedly was shot 28 times. 9 bullet wounds were found under his left arm, indicating to the coroner that Ginola saw his attackers and put his hand out in front of him. Luca Sarcona was reportedly killed in the same year, though details of his murder appear lost. Andrea Licato's death was significant for several reasons. He reputedly was one of the more accomplished members of the Good Killers gang. The July 24, 1917 murder of a Detroit police officer, Detective Sergeant Emmanuel Rogers, was attributed to him. Licato was also believed to have been one of the two men who betrayed Antonio Ginola. He might also have been involved with the later slaying of Detroit mob boss John Vitale. Licato was killed about mid-October of 1920. Detroit's McPherson revealed to the press that Licato was tortured. His arms were reportedly cut off before he was buried alive. Such extreme physical mistreatment seems to indicate a disciplinary killing. Shortly after the original list of 16 Good Killers victims was extracted from Fontana's confessions, several additional names were added to the growing public dialogue. Detroit killing of Mike Maltese was added to Fontana's list, appropriate if the Good Killers had been responsible for the slaying of Joseph Buccellato. Other additions from that city included Ginola brother-in-law Pasquale Dani and father and son John and Joe Vitale. Denis was slain during a February 2, 1919 attempt on the life of Sam Ginola. The two men were ambushed as they entered Ginola's home at Godol Street and Biddle Avenue that evening. Denis was hit by 4 slugs, 2 in the chest, 1 in the stomach, and 1 in the leg. Ginola escaped the attack unharmed. The Vitalis were dispatched during a wave of gang violence in the summer and fall of 1920, when Fontana was reportedly in New York City and unable to witness the incidents. Gunmen in a second floor window opened fire on the Vitalis as they entered the car in front of 2080 Russell Street on the morning of August 18th. John Vitale was wounded. His son Joe, 17, was killed instantly. John Vitale was successfully executed a month later. Police decided that he was thrown from an automobile on 14th Avenue near Marinette Avenue before dawn. His body was found in the street with 12 bullet holes in it. Police linked the killing with the earlier appearance of 6 Sicilian men at the Michigan Central Depot just blocks away. When a patrolman asked why they were in Detroit, they informed him that they had just arrived from Buffalo at Niagara Falls to attend a funeral. An automobile then came by and picked them up. Authorities speculated that Vitale might have been driving. Additional murders in New York were also linked to Antonio Mazzera and Antonio De Benedetto. On the evening of November 11, 1917, Fischetti told the New York press that Fontana's statements connected Mazzera and De Benedetto to good killer activities. Mazzera and De Benedetto had both been in Castellammare del Golfo, and their families were tightly knit. De Benedetto's clan was also linked through marriage with the Bonventres and the Magaddinos.
De Benetto's son, Charles Charlie Buffalo De Benetto, was a soldier under Salvatore Maranzano and Joseph Bonanno in the Castellammare's War of 1930-31. The two men were shot at close range at North 5th and Rebling Streets, within sight of the Bonaventure family home. Mazzera fell dead instantly. De Benetto lingered until he arrived at Eastern District Hospital. Police detective James Kinney, on his way home from work, heard the attack and chased two shooters. He managed to apprehend Antonio Massino, who was in possession of an empty revolver. Police kept an eye on Massino's Manhattan apartment and arrested Giuseppe Martinicchio as he entered it at 2 a.m. Two teenage girls who witnessed the shootings identified Massino and Martinicchio as the gunmen. Much of the story attributed to Fontana's confession borders on unbelievable. Certainly, the small barber would have required psychic abilities to acquire details of murders committed in the Midwest while he was in the East. Today, 85 years after the good killers were exposed, much of Fontana's story remains in conflict with commonly accepted underworld history.